Hello, and welcome to a quick video about a side effect of the way Godot handles shaders. One of the strong points in OpenGL is that you can compile shaders on the fly. The compiler tools are built in. Godot makes good use of this feature, but as with everything good, there is always a con. In this very simple example scene, I'll be showing this off, and it won't seem to have a huge impact. Seeing I do a lot in VR, however, the effect is very jarring, especially with OpenVR, for which this is enough to throw you out of your game for a second. Luckily, once you know why this is happening, it's also very easy to solve. What you see here is a simple cube with a very basic spatial material and a plane used as our floor, which has normal mapping and a depth texture enabled. You can also see two sliders and two tick boxes. I'm showing off a scenario here that you won't generally use in a game, however, it showcases the problem fairly well. I'll discuss more common scenarios that you will encounter later in the video. The first slider controls our PBR metallic value, and the second our PBR roughness. When we adjust the metallic slider, we see that the change in effect is immediate. The same with our roughness. We can change it, and it just works. When we untick our normal tick box to turn the normal mapping on our floor off, however, you'll see the game pauses for a fraction of a second. But it only happens once. After that, I can turn this on and off without issues. The same happens with our depth. The first time I turn it off, we get a pause. After that, it's all good. So what's happening? For this, I'm going to add a second cube to our scene, and we are going to apply a standard spatial material. Let's first look at how our metallic and roughness settings on our material work. We can see, as I change the sliders in the property editor, that our material reacts like before. Now our spatial material actually creates a Godot shader in the background, and you have this cool feature where you can change your spatial material into a shader material. Now we can edit the shader, and when we look at the code for this shader, it is really basic. We have some uniforms at the top, we have a one-liner for a vertex shader, and we have some very basic code in our fragment shader that control all our basic PBR properties. What is important here is that all our inputs that we are using here are currently uniforms, and uniforms we can change without changing the shader itself. This is how we can change our metallic and roughness, and the new settings are just applied to our material. But now let's recreate our spatial material and instead turn normal mapping and depth mapping on. Now we convert this to a shader material again. Whoa! Suddenly there is a lot more code in our shader. The code related to the depth map more than doubles the amount of code in our shader. So changing this setting changes our shader's code. And changing our shader's code requires us to compile our shader. And that is what causes our pause. Now you might think, why add or remove that code? Why not have a shader that does it all and you just put an if statement in? That's what you do in GDScript or C++. Well, you'd be surprised to know that even if your if statement returns false, it's still possible it has already been executed and its results is simply getting discarded. Having dozens of cores available to parallel process your shader code, sometimes it's more effective to run code and discard its results. That dead shader code that you're not using, it actually takes up valuable GPU resources. Not adding code that you don't need, especially complex code like depth mapping, will have a serious impact in your game. Now obviously, you wouldn't very likely turn this sort of feature on and off mid-game. But what is very likely is that you might load and spawn scenes that contain materials with settings resulting in a shader that has not been compiled yet. Say the first time your character fires a bullet. You instantiate your bullet scene. That bullet is rendered with a material that has a shader that hasn't been compiled yet. And bingo. The trick is to trick Godot into compiling your shader when your level first loads. And with spatial materials, this is really easy. One really cool thing about spatial materials is that it caches the shaders it compiles. This is why we could turn our normal map and our death map back on without it having a hiccup again. What is even cooler is that all spatial materials share the same cache. So I'm going to add a spatial node as a child node to my camera. We have to trick Godot into rendering an object with each shader we'll be using, because only then the shader gets compiled. By adding these as child nodes to our camera, we can ensure they will get rendered regardless of changing our camera position. Note that any material that is part of the scene we load at the get-go, we don't have to worry about. So for us, we need to create two objects with two materials. First, we start with a mesh instance that we call Death Without Normals. I'm adding a plane here that I make very small. We don't actually want to see it. And now we add a spatial material. We don't care about any of the settings. All we care about is that we turn Death and Parallax on. That generates the shader code we need. Now we create a second mesh instance that we call Normals Without Death. Again, I'm adding my plane. And now we create a spatial material with just the normal map enabled. We want to move our objects slightly forward so they are in our view frustum. Finally, we add a bit of code to our main script that will hide our shader cache node after process has run two times. This is long enough to be sure that by now our shaders will have been compiled. We don't remove them because that would destroy our shaders. When we now try out our project, we can verify that our sliders still work as expected. But we'll notice that ticking and unticking our normal or death tick boxes no longer results in a hiccup. Godot will simply select one of the cached shaders. So this solves it for spatial materials. For shader materials, the principle is the same, but Godot doesn't have an easy way to know that two shaders are actually the same. Here the tip is to always save your shader code to a shader resource. If you use the same shader for multiple materials, Godot is smart enough to know that it is the same shader because you're using the same shader resource. Simply add a mesh instance, but now add a shader material that uses your shader resource. Again, you don't need to set up anything. Just having the shader associated with the material used by a mesh that gets rendered is enough for Godot to trigger compiling it. And that's all there is to that. If this video helped you, I would appreciate a like. See you all next time!